for this afternoon is IP ownership and exploitation in universities and our research institutes. So in addition to educating students who are the leaders of our future generations, universities and research institutes play a pivotal role in generating intellectual property rights through research and other activities. They contribute new and innovative ideas to enhance the economic growth of a nation. And we've got an esteemed lineup of people here. Very long bios. I'll try to shorten these bios. First on the panel, we have Dr. Rahul Verma from EvaluServe. Dr. Rahul is the Global Head of Operations, Intellectual Property and R&D Solutions Group at EvaluServe. He has been with the group for over 12 years and has been instrumental in growing the IP team to the largest IP and R&D solutions group in the world. Next, we have Zakir Jaffar, who is Ahmad Zakir Datuk Wira Jaffar from UPM. He's the CEO of commercialization. He was pulled out of the industry, he was saying, to help out with the university in this process of commercialization. So welcome. We have Dr. Jasmine Kuei from Trans-Pacific. Jasmine is responsible for connecting with organizations, companies, research organizations, and government agencies to create value from their IP. So prior to joining Trans-Pacific IP, Jasmine was director of the National University of Singapore Industry Liaison Office, where she was responsible for university industry alliances and partnerships and negotiating licenses and corporate-sponsored research agreements. And Jasmine earned her Doctor of Philosophy degree in Physical Oceanography from the National University of Singapore and a Bachelor of Engineering in Honours in Civil Engineering. Next, we have Professor Dr. Rofina Yasmin Osman, who is a director at the University of Malaya Centre for Innovation and Commercializations. That's UMCIC. In 1990, on completion of an MSc at the University of Malaya, Dr. Yasmin was awarded a Chevening Scholarship to pursue a PhD in plant virology at the John Innes Institute of Plant Science in the UK. And she was the founding head of the Centre for Research in Biotechnology for Agriculture and the first chair of the university's Biotechnology and Bioproduct Cluster. So, a great lineup. Moderating today's session is Azima Abdulkadir, who is the Senior Manager, Corporate Research Strategy Division of MIMOS Berhad. And of course, we know that as an agency of the Ministry of Science, Technology and Innovation, MOSTI. She had set up and headed the IP Management and Strategies Department of MIMOS from 2008 to 2014. She's also a co-inventor of a granted patent and 6 pending patents in Malaysia. She holds a Master in IP from the Law Faculty of the National University of Malaysia, and she's currently a PhD candidate at the Kuala Lumpur University. So let me help, please help me welcome Azima, who will be moderating this session.
All right. As we know, the title that was given for this session is IP Ownership and Exploitation in Universities and RI. Now, to make it to make the session flow smoothly, this is how we're going to do it. Now, we have 4 speakers. We're going to immediately touch on 3 major scope that we have agreed on among all speakers. First, we're going to touch about the importance of IP ownership at driving returns on IP investments. Okay. And secondly, we're going to touch on demand for technology value versus market needs. Okay. And last but not least, all of us will collaborate and discuss on exploration and exploitation. I believe this scope is very much close to the heart of all of us who are very active in the university and the research institution. Okay, and of course, I would like to remind the speakers that the discussion today is going to be in accordance with the theme of the conference, Accelerate ASEAN. Okay, so that's another pinch of salt that I'm adding to the scope that's given by the organizer. Right, first and foremost, then I would like to invite Prof. Yasmin, right, where Prof. Yasmin is going to touch on the first topic, the importance of IP ownership at driving returns on IP investment. And she's going to touch about effective IP management versus strategic IP management, looking at ownership and exploitation window. Prof told me that she's going to throw a problem statement for her colleague speakers to dwell with and discuss further. So without further ado, may I invite Prof. Rufina Yasmin?
Thank you very much. I'm not sure I'm going to answer all those questions, and I'm certainly going to just open the floor, actually, for, thank you very much, Fazima. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. So I just have a few slides. Apparently, I'm the only one with slides, and that's why we're not on the stage yet. But I thought I'd like to just set the context of today's discussion with my own experience at the University of Malaya. And of course, I can give a little plug for my university as well. So IP, in University of Malaya, we put a lot of importance in collaboration with industry, and really at the end of the day, that's what a lot of us feel are the correct custodians and recipients of the technologies and the knowledge that we derive in universities. But the question is really how do we get there, and are we all on the same page? I just came back from another meeting this morning where industry was talking about industry university collaboration, and really highlighting one of the biggest challenges is getting everybody to have the same shared values in doing a project, and it's one of the biggest challenges that we have. So in UM, we do a lot of industry collaborations. Not all of them involves IP, and certainly the ones that do involve IP transfer between the university and the industry are the ones that are most challenging for us. Because anything that has the term ownership, yeah, creates all sorts of barriers, I feel, and all sorts of issues that maybe it'll be nice to discuss today how we can address this. Still, we signed a lot of agreements last year, and we were quite successful in a lot of some of this transfer of intellectual property. And just as a plug for UM, we did this because the government has really placed a lot of faith in the universities, especially in the research universities, and has funded us in such a way that we are able to grow reasonably well in the last few years. And you can see, we have a very big comprehensive university. We have a big enrollment. We have a large number of academic staff. And we have really good research output. We publish more than 3,000 ISI papers per year in the last few years. So, and because of that, we also generate a lot of intellectual property. And hence with now our real challenge is, yes, we own a lot of intellectual property, more than 2,000 IP. But where are we headed with that, and how are we going to really translate that to return of investment for the public, really? Then I go back to why we're doing it. And recently, the Prime Minister launched the Malaysian Education Blueprint, which is a 10-year program, which outlines how the universities have to transform to be relevant and to contribute to nation building, really. And one of the big shifts, as they call it, they have 10 shifts, 10 things that we must shift our shift ourselves. I'll remove a word from there. After shift ourselves, it's really in the innovation ecosystem, and they do outline some strategies and how will we achieve this. It's really to have the supporting ecosystems for the commercialization of ideas, which is like strengthening tech transfer office. I was really happy with that. You know, for those tech transfer friends out there, it's a big achievement for us. We are now official. And the mechanism of really transferring our knowledge out from university to the recipients, the stakeholders, whether it's industry or whether it's the community. And so that infrastructure of ownership transfer, and when we talk about ownership, it's ownership of ideas, ownership of not just on patents, ownership of knowledge, is the biggest challenge that we are facing at the moment. So here's, of course, this classic quadruple helix that we all show, you know, when we talk about building this ecosystem. And we know that all this emphasis on research, development, building research universities, moving universities up the ranking, creation of of high impact programs has really resulted in a lot of intellectual property being produced from the universities and RIs in Malaysia. And I just again saw some figures recently, this morning really, that in the last 10 years, Malaysian universities have filed more than 7,000 patents. And so that's really an indication of how much we have put into research funding in the last few years. So Malaysia stands at putting, I think, 1.07% of the GERD into research. And it's beginning to translate to things like patents. But this, is again, is output. So where do we go from here? We have the numbers, and we're having, you know, we really are showing the figures of growth. We are the highest rate of publication, rate of increase in publication in the world at the moment, Malaysia, in terms of incremental publications being produced by universities. So, you know, everybody's paying attention, but again, are we ready for the consequence? So, universities, of course, supposedly is the solution provider, and this is what government is proposing, that we be, in the next 10 years, that we be the solution provider, that we provide the information, the knowledge, and the intellectual property to drive the innovation ecosystem. And in theory, that is really what our role is, you know, and we absorb risk, we absorb costs, because we are largely funded by public funds, and we enable, hopefully, technological innovation to move up the value chain by providing all this background. And we also know that this process is not an easy one, and that having ownership of intellectual property doesn't mean that we're going to graduate and be successful. I have another colleague in the panel here who is largely successful in moving a lot of things, and I'm very interested to see how we can put that into context as well in today's discussion. But this is a long road, and this is a road filled with a lot of, again, different ideas from different sides of the fence that, you know, we're still learning to understand how to do it. So what is it? So this is my IP portfolio in 2004, and you can see when we received research university status, University of Malaya patent portfolio has increased tremendously. And last year, we outdid MIMOS, sorry, we outdid MIMOS as the top patent filer for 2014. yes, for MIMOS, it's very strategic. But I'm sure it takes a lot of pressure off you, because now the pressure is on me. So basically, it's not fun. I met my KPIs, I exceeded them, but it's not fun because this is not translating yet to industry rushing through my door saying, I want your IP, you know, and I want to share all this with you, and I don't know why. Maybe we can share why. So I have a growing portfolio, and I think all the universities here have a growing portfolio of IPR. And so this is a great opportunity. So, and we do see an increasing demand. I get a lot more hits, really, from international industry. Perhaps one of my researchers asked, is it in only international industry that read patent, you know, when patents are actually published? Who actually reads it? Because really, we do get very quick response. The moment a patent is published internationally, we get very quick response from multinationals and people, you know, wanting to talk to our researchers and stuff. So it's very fast, but much less from Malaysia. So again, are we teaching our industry to look out, to search for new patents? Are we teaching our industry to know when a patent suddenly comes out? Or are we expecting the university to come out there and knock on every door and tell you, look, I have a patent. You know, it's an issue. So we would like to accelerate the transfer of IP and technologies to industry as a solution provider in Malaysia especially. But how can we do it better is the question. The top of my mind, it's at the top of my mountain here. And this year we're going for the same numbers. And we have the output because we published 6,000 papers last year, 3,000 over in ISI journals, 3,000 over in non-ISI journals. That is a lot of intellectual property. I mean, 200 is just the tip of an iceberg for us in terms of protecting intellectual property. But, you know, we need a plan. So today, that's why I'm here. Thank you. Oh. Sorry, I have the ASEAN contacts. ASEAN context is we will be at the One ASEAN Entrepreneurship Summit, Entrepreneurship Summit in November, support of MOF, NSU, sell a face there. And You Start ASEAN is one of our initiatives in trying to move intellectual property through startup companies. And we are hosting You Start ASEAN, bringing together university startups from around the ASEAN region in November. So I know a lot of my colleagues here will be supporting this in November. Thank you.
Right, thank you, Prof. Now, may I invite all the members of the panel? All right, thank you, Prof, again, for setting the pace for discussion today. All right, as you have seen, how do we transform an effective, so-called effective IP management into a strategic IP management? So, Prof has actually shown us how UM has done it. First, by positioning. No, she's really managed to take over Vimal's profile in a very short term. Immediately, almost immediately, isn't it? Otherwise, it's always UPM, Vimal's, UTM, Vimal's, UPM, UTM. And now suddenly, I looked up at the announcement and I said, UM? Wow, Prof did something there. So, well, that is a true example, how someone has actually take charge of the strength that is that resides within the organization. So I think we are next. This is where we will dwell further into ownership. How do we understand the ownership rights and so on? And this is where I would like to invite Dr. Jasmine Kui. She's going to touch about ownership of rights versus ownership of knowledge or know-how. So how do we deal with that?
Thank you, Azima. And thank you, participants, for being here. And thank you, Professor Yasmin, for the good opening. I think the rest of us will not be using slides, so we'll be talking off the cuff. In terms of university technology transfer office, I mean, we talk about it. It is one of the most challenging jobs available in the industry. Our stakeholders have different perspectives. The finance department wants revenue. The school expects the university to teach students to generate new research. They want publications. They want high number of invention disclosure. Yet they want number of patents filed. At the end of it, the numbers look good. They turn around and say, "So how many of these have been commercialized?" So you can say, "I've licensed out 200. Then the next question is, so how much money have you generated, right? So then the next question is, so how many startups are you creating? So for startups, the model has always been equity. You're not going to see dollars until they exit. So what does that mean? How do you balance that? Having said that, does it mean that the university is not generating return on investments based on its investment in research? A university does research and creates new knowledge and also increase the capacity of its researchers and staff. That at the end of it, when it's translated to the industry or the society, we are looking at increasing knowledge base. We are looking at producing great students who can get good jobs in good companies. So jobs creation, new drugs, new products, new services. These are what we term as economic impact. So return on investments for universities should not be viewed solely based on, in my opinion, should not be viewed solely based on monetary returns, but the impact that all the research has created. So if you look at what leads to these impacts, it is more than registered rights. It is more than patents. It will include copyrights. It will include know-how. And that's why we talk about the importance between registered rights and non-registered rights. So the whole slew of it gets involved, including data. So oftentimes when industry comes to university, they are not only looking at your registered rights. They want the knowledge between the 2 years of your professors. They want to know, they want to collaborate because there is great depth of technical knowledge to complement their needs as the industry. To enhance the existing product, to bring them up in a more competitive way against their competitors. So a very roundabout way to answer the importance of know-how or rights to know-how. I think university oftentimes may not view this as important, but subtly, if you think about it, that's what the industry comes to you for. Patent documents, they can read off the patent documents, right? But it is what goes behind a patent document that is what they're trying to access to. So know-how is as important, copyright is as important, data is as important as your patents or other registered rights.
Thank you, Dr. Jasmine. Another trick that we always face, or we normally find, is that for the universities and RIs, when we want to use the, first we go out and seek for the quantity. We go out and make sure that we have enough numbers of patents or any other IP assets. Then we were told that we are supposed to commercialize it, make money out of it. And this is the trick when we started to venture out of our comfort domain. We start to go into the industry role. We start to pitch with the industry and getting them to convince to get and take up our technology or invention. And then suddenly we realize, hey, when the industry comes to our door, and then suddenly we realize that, you know, you turn around, there's no one behind you. Who's going to do it? Who's going to work on it for you? Who's going to develop the technology further? You know, we've done our part. We do the pitching, we do the marketing. And suddenly when we look behind, hey, there's no one there. Then we realize, oops, the inventors are students, they've left. Or, oops, the investors, the inventors, they are professors. They've decided to move on to another research. You know? So, and then we end up with a very difficult negotiation or deal, discussions with the industry, you see? The industry said, you convinced me that you have this. I'm coming to you now. Yeah, you know? So this goes. This will bring us to the next topic, which I would like to get some feedback from Prof. Yasmin and Dr. Jasmine as well, regarding continuous support. How challenging it is for the universities, yeah, on this matter. Please do.
I think it's incredibly challenging because we were talking about this earlier that. Researchers have a different viewpoint, a different horizon. So their horizon ends at a very different place than where our horizon actually begins, even. And for them, that was their key role, to generate knowledge, to publish a paper, to graduate a student, and they're so happy. And they've done it. They've achieved their academic goals. And I think it's already a challenge, the fact that to get a research culture going in university has already been a challenge in Malaysia. And you know, we have achieved something like 40%, 50% of academics doing research, but now we face the next challenge: how to get academics to look beyond the publication student horizon, and to look at real application, and that is a big challenge, I think. And it's about, I believe it's about education. I mean, we do roadshows now every month to try and just get researchers to be aware that at the end of the horizon there is more, that the world is not flat, you know, and that there is that we have to keep going until we see application. But the nice thing that I discovered is that in general, people who have chosen academia as their career are looking for an end. They're looking for their technologies to be applied. They're not necessarily, they're not interested to talk about money. They're not interested to talk about business, which is also a problem. They just want to say, as long as my technology is used, you know, and at least that was a nice discovery, but it is still an ongoing story.
I will talk a bit more about the Singapore experience. It's the same challenge. I think all universities face the same challenge. One of the things that, I mean, sometimes in the technology transfer office, we pick our battle. We know that there are a few percentage of professors who are uncooperative. So do we really want to meddle with their patents? Maybe not, you know. So let's focus on the more cooperative ones, because why waste time on it? I'm sorry. But having said that, truly, the whole education, the whole roadshow, the whole behavior change is a long-term process. But I think KPI works. Giving them some targets to meet based on industry funding. So I think Singapore started with that maybe about 10 years ago. And they upped the notch. And the next level was that for every grant that they apply for, then needs to have an industry partnership. That has its pros because in doing so, at a very early stage of research, they start to build a rapport with the company. The company becomes a natural licensee, right? So then after the licensing, there is this continuous partnership that goes on. So much so that there could be further license of improvements from the laboratory to the industry. And it could be vice versa too. Industry's improvement could be granted back to the research group, which helps them improve in knowing what industry wants. Then along the way, they start building research or doing research that's more relevant to the industry. So we do that a lot, including proof of concept grants, proof of value grants, clinical trial grants. You need an industry driver. I was also mentioning that in recent years, maybe 3 years ago, NUS started accepting practice track professors. So you don't have to come up through the academic route as public university. Professors, or you come from industry, you can go into the professor track. So that really builds that kind of immersion. So having industry people within the professors, they start talking about relevance, they start getting everybody else comfortable. Students, for sure, is a very good influence to the professors. You know, having very entrepreneurial students will drive the professors of knowing what's relevant. So professors should stay very acute and tuned to good research, but they should have that perspective of what it means in the other world. Of course, this is good, but I think when it comes again to expectations of timeline, I think researchers don't have timeline in their mind. Professors, yeah, the timeline is like stretched. But industry wants it quick. So there has been a lot of frustration. So I think managing, educating, making sure before the university signs on that licensing agreement or collaboration agreement, the professors know what they're walking into. Continuous support is important because technologies from universities are so raw. The industry will definitely need a continued advice on technical side on how to put that technical part of things into the existing products, without which they're going to come back and return you or terminate the license agreement. So once again, it goes back to working on projects and patents and licensing and negotiation for a collaborative researcher behind you.
Thank you so much. All right. I would like to remind everyone we have about 30 minutes before 2. So we have 30 minutes to go. And we have 2 more scopes to cover. All right. So we'll do this in more strategic way. And this is where we're going to have two-way communication. As and when the speakers are, you know, elaborating their points, audience, you can just raise your hand, you can ask any question, right? So it's a free flow, right? I think it's, I prefer it that way because looking at the hour that we are in now, right? Okay, so we've heard from both from Prof. Yasmin and Dr. Jasmine as to how the university's experience in terms of deliberating on the research products, as well as how to ensure continuous support for proceeding into commercialization. It's quite challenging, yeah, because for universities to understand what is it that the market wants, what is it that will entice the market to open their door. The market will perceive, this is too theoretical, this is too academic, or they will think like, I will have to invest in testing, in doing development. So there'll be a lot of issues that will come back to ownership, right? So there's a lot of discussion in this area. But looking at the new way of how can we forecast or predict what are the requirements that the market expects, what are the market expectations, and what can we use, what can we use actually to help us to understand and to help us to decide, right? So that brings us to the next scope, demand for technology value versus market needs. Now, I would like to next invite Dr. Rahul, who will speak about understand IP portfolio strengths and understanding market needs. Right, over to you.
Thank you, Hazima. And a very good afternoon to all of you. I think first of all, I should really thank the audience and also the organizers. This is my fourth trip to Malaysia. So much so that this time my family asked me, why do you keep going to Kuala Lumpur? We want to accompany you to see, you know, why do you go there? So, but it's a great opportunity for me to share my experiences, and it's a very interesting topic, and also the background that has been laid down by my previous speakers. So let me, you know, touch upon a few themes which I think I'll elaborate on. So one is, I think the quantity versus quality, if I can, you know, pick that theme up, because Professor Yasmin talked about, you know, the numbers there, 7,000 patents, but do they actually translate into value? So how do you actually then, you know, set up a culture where this value, you know, is ingrained right from the very start, right from when the seed of IP is sown, that is from the idea generation stage. So I think I'll touch upon that. Then I'll also briefly touch upon, you know, the tools that are available for helping you, or the latest trends that are there to help you see how you are able to maximize or build your portfolio. So I think in terms of the quantity versus quality game, I think it is very important that at the very start, when we are actually looking at, you know, building an idea, we should have an idea-centric R&D program where, you know, you are looking at primarily, if you have to build this idea, then what does the market need, right? And you do an analysis where not only you are looking at, you know, yes, whether this idea is novel or not, but you inbuilt at that stage a market need that this will address. So I think that's very important, where, you know, universities are trying to create invention disclosure forms as a part of a process of, you know, trying to see if they have to generate an IP. At that stage, there is a capture of what is the commercial potential of this idea. You know, what is the market need that this idea is going to address? And with that kind of an approach or a structure or a framework process that you have, then that helps you capture that idea and the market that idea may have, or the potential commercial, you know, potential commercial impact this idea may have at the very beginning. And then second is that after this is done, then you also need to look at what are the competing, you know, technologies out there. And this is where technology comes in, where in terms of patent mining, patent analytics, you can actually look at that, what are the competing technologies. But more importantly, you can look at the trends. So there are technologies which can help you understand the problem solution approach in a particular technology area. So you can see that, okay, there's a particular problem that your idea is going to address, then what are the kind of solutions people are approaching? And, you know, where are the gaps that are there in those solution offerings that your idea may actually potentially bridge or fill that gap? So that actually helps you, you know, start realizing that your idea would have commercial impact, because you are trying to create a niche for your idea. You're already trying to identify what is the market that your idea is going to capture. So that's there. And I think moving on, what I would take reference to is, I don't know how many of you attended the session in the morning by Edward Jung, where he said that, you know, the world is flat, where, you know, essentially collaboration is what will drive innovation more and more, right? And that is what you need to also see. If you have an idea, you're doing research, there may be a parallel research which is happening in another corner of the world. So how do you connect with that? And that is where patent analytics can help you identify those research groups. And the objective here is not to, you know, replicate or be the first one to make that breakthrough, but it is to see how you can collaborate to fast track your development, to fast track your research, and come up with a product where you can commercialize this much earlier. So that's what I would like to add here. And then last point that I want to make is the overall portfolio management. So, you know, I'll take one example. I was in Korea a week back, And I was talking to one of the largest electronics majors in Korea. I will not take the name. No one can guess it as well. So, but then I was talking to the head of IP acquisitions of that group. And we were helping them in trying to identify future technologies. And his key focus was that, please look for technologies only from universities and only technologies which have been filed as a patent. Because we do not want to look at technologies which are, just in the either initial stages or do not have an IP around it. So I think it is very important that, for you to actually look out or be placed in the global map. And Professor Yasmin said, she files a patent and she receives calls from multinationals. So all these multinationals, are looking for, inventions coming from universities, because then they can collaborate. They can actually look at what the next breakthrough would be. And if you are actually filing a patent, that actually puts you on their radar. I think that's one key important aspect of IP. And that's also the Asian aspect, because this head of IP acquisition said, I'm looking for IP coming out of, Southeast Asia and developing countries, because there's a concept he introduced called glocalization, that I want to look at technologies which will address problems in these local geographies, which address the needs of these local customers. This is glocalization, that I, as a multinational company, I have the horsepower to develop those products, but I need solutions which are, based on local customer needs, right? So look at your portfolio, look at the needs that you're addressing, have IP that puts you on the radar of these multinational companies. And that's what helps you build your portfolio and, helps you in commercialization. So, long things.
Thank you, Dr. Rahul. Yeah, the takeaway is, how do you position your organization on the world map so that the others, the potential buyers, the potential investors, they can see you and they start to wonder, what is your role? What are you doing? How far can it grow? Because an investor would not want to invest for the sake of investing. They want to see the market potential, the opportunities. We will come into that later, right? So after knowing or understanding your strengths and what you have internally, now, how do you put everything to use? How do you use it? Understanding is not enough. It's still in the idea form. You understand, you verify, you validate. But how do you actually make use of your intangible assets? Yeah. So with this, I would like to invite Dr. Zakir and Encik Zakir, soon to be Dr. Ami. Okay, Encik Zakir. Okay, he will share his experience as the CEO of UPM Science Park.
Thank you, Puan. Assalamualaikum. It's interesting that Puan Zima put that into context of how do you use it. I would say around loopholes. That's the best way I can look at it at university level, because university have so many policies and bureaucracies that we have to work with. I do understand from a perspective of, congratulations to UM and Prof. Rofina with the numbers and with the big names. And similar to UPM, we do have big names like Boeing, Intel that work with us at international level too. But at the national level, Malaysian national level context, we have Snemberhards, small enterprise, well, not enterprise anyways, Snemberhards and public listed that come to us. They do look at patents, they do look at the big inventions, but we do have to, not I would say muzzle through, we do have to work around some of this intellectual property to make sure it work, because some of them at the national level, they want something that university have research, but at the same time, something that is substantial for them to work with in terms of dollars and cents. If you look at vaccines, if you look at nanotubes, they are too expensive for Snemberhard to make it through. But at times, we have to make do with some of the intellectual properties that is suitable for them in terms of values and in terms of dollars and cents, in terms of licensing fee. So we do have to work around it in order to make sure that it works in terms of if some of the research are not be able to, it's too expensive to copyright it, to patent it and to put in an IP, we have to probably into put into a document technology know-how, and it will be slightly cheaper. So, meaning that, it of course, we still target the international market, but the national market, even the those that come and knock on our doors, the Malaysian companies, they don't have that big money to buy. So, at the TTO office, we have to make do and work around it. This is the other thing that I think for us at the, we are experiencing at the national level. I mean, of course, we want to generate our economy, and of course, we want to make sure that the Malaysian society benefits from the research that we have done. And these are the contexts that, you know, that the TTO officers have to work into. How can we make it cheaper? You know, how can we make it doable? Juan Azima mentioned in terms of the usage of it. How can the industry eventually use it? We have, research in psychology, you know. They are not big research in any format compared to the science base, but it is still research. It is still something a service consultancy company can buy and use that technology. But how can we make it into intellectual property? We have to turn it into a document copyright. We have to turn it into intellectual property. So these things are something that, at the end of the day, the TTO officer have to be creative in order to make it work and to apply it at the usage sense. Of course, at the university level, we say that, yeah, it's usable. Yeah, at the lab level, it's usable. But how can we translate that into the industry? For us, we have various means and resources that we managed to pull it through. Again, all around the loopholes within the university level, because there are so many bureaucracies and so many policies. We were just talking before lunch just now. Universities transferring technology have to be from bottom up. It's not from the top level initiative. The bottom up, the TTO officers and the researchers really have to find ways and means in order to how circumvent the whole policies and the ways to make it work. Puan?
Yes. Yeah, I concur with that. I mean, from our experience itself, you know, in order to show something, you have to prove it first. That's always the challenge for the practitioners in this field, right? You have to show that it's working. You have to prove, you have to lead the way. You have to convince everyone that, okay, this is something that is worth to look at, to hold on to. For example, when Malaysia's flag was first listed in the list of top patent filers in the WIPO report in 2012, Malaysia was ranked first, they bagged the seventh place, and then Malaysia bagged the sixth place. And when we look at the name of the, this is just from patent filing strategy, yeah. And when we look at the list of name, and we saw, oh, we did something for MIMOS. I mean, MIMOS, we did something. We managed to get the Malaysian flag into the report. And immediately after that, we've been receiving calls from overseas. You know, I attended conferences, and then when they saw our name card, and they say, hey, you, MIMOS from Malaysia. Yes. Say, we've been following you. Okay, thank you. And I was shy myself away, because I'm not ready. I'm not sure how do I deal with this, you know, how do I deal with this, you know, and then when we come back and I say, look, we can't shine now. I mean, we can't hide ourselves. We have ventured into something new. Now we have to run the show. We need to pull more people. We need more people from Malaysia, more participants from Malaysia to be in the same group to drive the program. And to start to speak out, you know, and that's why, you know, looking at the discussion that we have today, listening to what Prof. Yasmin, Dr. Jasmine, Dr. Rahul, and Cik Zaki have shared with us today, it's just, look, the topic is just about IP ownership, gosh, and we are looking at so many issues that relates back to IP ownership, talking about the people, the resources, talking about the market, talking about the need to understand the data, to understand patent document, that's what Dr. Rahul mentioned. All the while, as we know, we can ask so many colleagues I have here who are very well versed in patent drafting. They can say, whoosh, how do I put all the technical stuff, claims, and to combine it with the legal protection in the claims, and then next, now we're talking about how do you put in the business factors into your claim? How can you do that? you know, looking at what Dr. Zakir meant, and Dr. Zakir, I mean, Dr. Zakir, Encik Zakir. Encik Zakir, soon to be.
Yes, the operator
is now. Okay, looking at how do you put usability now, if your patent document, your claims do not have these aspects, you don't have the business applicability features in the claim. I mean, although you can sell it, you can sell it out, you can license it, but how do people use your rights? Yeah. So although that it's translated into ownership, but what value can we get out of it? Yeah. So that is one idea, one issue that we're looking at. Now, next we're looking at, if this is the situation now, looking at our portfolio or patent that we lack certain strengths, how do we go about with the licensing terms? How do we negotiate with our potential buyers, or potential partners or collaborators? I'm sure there's a lot of hurdles, challenges that we faced. Initially, before we started with the session today, we had a virtual conversation, and then this morning I tried to catch up with all the speakers, trying to put all our discussion in place, and then we've exchanged experience. Dr. Jasmine shared with me her experience in doing negotiation with her clients, putting her minds in the clients' minds, looking and trying to look at and understand what are their expectations. And Dr. Rahul sharing with me earlier how he had actually worked on with his clients to develop a good opportunity for them to license, right? And to provide them the justification for their negotiations, right? And personally, I also shared with them that previously in my industrial experience, I've been engaged in a licensing term, cross-border licensing of trade secret, not even patent. Yeah. So we've done, this can be done, but first, what are the issues? What are the things that we need to know, right? So with this, I would like now to invite all the four speakers to start and discuss what are the issues that we normally face when we go into licensing deals, when we go into negotiations, especially from the universities or RI perspective, looking at, you know, you are not an industry. You don't have an available market, right? So how can you convince your buyers or your partners to accept your terms, right? So how should we go about? First, I'm asking for volunteer, Prof. Okay.
Well, I could talk all day about this, but no. I mean, this is the most challenging. I think it starts with like what Raul said. You have to know your technology, and it really starts from there. And I think that's a lesson learned for us, is that you have to be realistic about the state of your technology, and where you're heading. And then you have to also know who you're dealing with in terms of the industry and their readiness as well. So at the end of the day, you have to be able to speak many languages. You have to, I think Fadela, he's in the audience, he says, be able to work in many different time zones, and I don't mean a GMT, because the time zone of a researcher is not the same as the time zone of an industrial industry colleague. Yeah, so you need. I think the TTO office is really, really essential you really have to know both sides of the story. And licensing, I think it is an art. It's something we are learning all the time. As I said, it begins with knowing exactly what you have in your hand and exactly who you're dealing with. We have a problem in university in that we know that most of our technologies are really not off the shelf, and this is the biggest problem, as Chizake said. When we deal with most of the companies in Malaysia, SME companies, of course, the majority of companies in Malaysia are SMEs, and we would really love to be able to transfer our technologies to them, but they are not ready for development work. So they are ready for off-the-shelf products, ready, packaged, labeled, and just, you know, if possible, we produce it for them and transfer everything. You know,
stock,
lock, stock and barrel. It doesn't happen that way, and this is our biggest challenge, to find a middle ground, to find a way to work with. We would like to see intermediates be more prominent in Malaysia, accelerators, development institutes, to be the interface before a licensing deal can go through with small companies. But in terms of big companies, as I said, similarly, we introduced more recently an easy license. We have an engagement period, so to speak. I think it's a very popular concept nowadays. There's a lot of terms for it, going piece license and free license. But we do a short-term easy license where we try and get to know each other. And yeah, dating. And allow a little bit of leeway for industry to learn about our technologies and then make the decision before we go into a long-term contract. Because, the marriage, once you get married, then yeah. If you don't know your partner well and suddenly discover it on the wedding night, it's not a good deal. So anyway, it's a learning process, and I think it's about knowing both sides of the story. It's about speaking all the languages. Yeah, thank you.
In 5 minutes. Go ahead. I just
want to
wrap up something.
Sure. No. Okay. Sorry, I think since morning I've been, really not the best, right? I think there's just one thing I wanted to share based on the experience I have working with, inventors and universities or startups who are, trying to deal with negotiation and trying to get in investors. It's something called the reference-based claiming, where you can actually, once you are at a stage where you know that, yes, you had already filed a patent, but your technology has developed much more, or the industry has developed much more, in the last 2 or 3 years since you actually first filed a patent. Then what you need to do before you enter into negotiations or you develop your pitch book, try to see if there are, products or future products where your patent may actually have maybe mapping onto the features of those products or technologies. So then based on those, then try to see if you want to build your portfolio, right, more. And that will add much more value to your portfolio rather than a single patent or a set of patents, because then you can show that the claims of your patent are reading onto some product features or technologies which are in development. And that puts a much higher valuation to your portfolio around IP than just having, a single patent or just a set of patents. So, yeah.
Oh, really? No, just a bit of the evaluation. I think we talk about many different perspectives. Of course, pricing is one, but if you look at your licensee as your partner, work through the terms in a more collaborative way. Don't ask for too much upfront, ask for reasonable milestones, help them along to hit the milestones, because when that happens, you get some returns. So their success is going to be your success. And if I hear correctly, I think there were some requirements in Malaysia that you need to work with the local industry first as a licensee. So when Zahir mentioned that they don't have the monetary power to pay, then the question is, how do you establish that good relationship with them? Because then you can start introducing the big players while they license and work towards something more marketable, or when they reduce the risk. Mm-hmm. And of course, startups. I mean, one of the routes that Singapore took really is to invest in startup companies. So that in itself would have taken, lowered the risk of the early stage technology substantially. And hence increasing the value that we are able to negotiate with an existing company. Very quickly, 1 minute, I just want to touch on, we talk about patent claims being too narrow, not being able to read on existing products. As a company, we have been engaged by huge companies who are looking at Asia as a very good source of IP. The reason being, more than 50%, based on statistics, more than 50% of the world's researchers are now residing in Asia for various reasons. Funding is huge, opportunity is huge. I think we contribute more than 50% of the world R&D expenditure in Asia. So that's why everybody's flocking back, everybody's moving to Asia. So large companies are looking at how do we mine all these patents. Clients who have come to us, they do not actually want filed patents. Because oftentimes, universities may not be aware of what product that would be. The claims may not read on any product, or it would be so narrow. What they want then is to identify the good research groups. We walk in to talk to the research group and craft patterns around that. So that's another different approach, whereby then you are not looking at patterns as a way to sell your expertise, but how do you profile your research group through its publications, through profiles of various other forms to highlight their expertise. So in that way, you are mining patterns that are needed by the industry, and immediately they will take that on as a license.
Macam Prof juga, I have a lot to say, but maybe you will be rambling along. First, in terms of the national and international, local and international interest, Prof is right. The international companies, they observe or they look at patents more than national ones. I think it is awareness. Malaysian companies not aware that universities can be a good leverage for them to extend their companies further to really diversify. I think kurang apa tu kefahaman macam mana university boleh can leverage in a university. That is one. That is why, of course, compared to the Western world, you know, they are so advanced in using universities to do research. So we need to have more awareness of local SMEs to leverage more universities. That's one part I want to say. The other part is in terms of what Dr. Jasmine mentioned. The other trend that we are beginning to see is the macam Prof kata juga tadi, Prof Rovina, that we have to make it easy for companies to work with us in terms of not to say it's free time to test the research. they do pay a little bit upfront, very minimal, but we want them to get warm up dengan university first because it's very difficult. The transfer part of the technology is very risky. We're trying to minimize the duration.
So you're saying gone are the days where they can flirt with you?
Oh, no. We still have to, you know, courtship too important. But we're trying to reduce the numbers of months of transferring technology to, because during those months, the longer the period, the more emotion, you know, among researchers and companies, we can go upheaval. So for us, the best way to reduce the risk of transferring of technology is through startups based on the researcher participating together with the company. So you're beginning to see a lot more in Malaysian universities, incubators, accelerators, researchers setting up their own companies, collaborating with industry to set up a Senyum Berhad, new Senyum Berhad, even though that company might be have established. These are new trends that we're beginning to see. Even in UPM now, we have our own incubator. I'm not talking about the MTDC incubator. We have our own incubator. 26 researchers set up their own company. But kita pupuk dia, we incubate that in company together. So that's a startup on its own. Yeah.
All right. Thank you very much to our panel speakers, Dr. Yasmin, Prof. Yasmin, Dr. Jasmine, Dr. Rahul and Encik Zakir, right, for a very informative sharing of their experience and know-how with respect to IP ownership and exploitation. Again, I think the time is up, right? So I think I will now hand it over back to Ms. Frida.
Thank you so much. And I'm sure you all have questions, and I hope you all be around a little later to chat with them. We're going to move on to the next session. Before that, again, thank you very much, Professor Yasmin, Dr. Jasmine, Puan Azimah, for moderating, Dr. Rahul, and of course, the newly appointed Dr. Zakir. Thank you. And so we'll be doing, thank you very much, and we'll be doing a quick turnaround for our next session, which is on 3D printing and Internet of Things and IP.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.